Video Guy. That's the title that was given to me at San Jose State. When I went to college there, I videotaped sporting events for the Spartans athletic teams. A classmate of mine in the sports management department, Kirk Redfern, was the athletic department's video coordinator. He asked me if I wanted to join his team of filmers, and I said sure. The year was 1995, and I began my sports videotaping during the Spartans football training camp. It was great. They had coaches like Reuben Carter, a former NFL player who coached the defensive linemen, and the head coach was his coach for the Denver Broncos, John Ralston. Positions such as offensive linemen learned how to work as a team. Coaches worked on techniques with players, and players got in shape. The players practiced all aspects of the game, quickly moving from one drill to another. Special helmet covers were used for identification purposes during special teams drills. When a player was injured, the training staff rushed to the fallen Spartan. They assessed the injury and provided appropriate care for the player. The top offensive player was Brian Roach, a senior who had been named All-WAC tight end as a junior. One of the running backs was the reliable Patrick Walsh, who also played baseball for the San Jose State team. Carl Dean, a solid transfer from Bakersfield Junior College, won the quarterback position. Wendrell Hayes was an explosive threat as a wide receiver and kick returner. Two top Spartan defensive players, defensive lineman Howard Butler and linebacker Jacob Malai. As the season grew near, the practices became more intense and players on the sideline couldn't wait to get their chance. Sports Information Director Lawrence Fan would come to practice daily to check up on the Spartans. Students would come to practice also. And sometimes they got an up close and personal view. At the end of training camp, the Spartans were ready for the 1995 season. San Jose State has a rich historic past. The school started in San Francisco as Mims Evening Normal School in 1857. In 1871, the school moved to San Jose and was renamed California State Normal School. By 1895, the Normal School had a football team and was playing league games. Now called San Jose State College, the 1938 team was among the West Coast's best teams. Head coach Dudley DeGroote's team went 11-1 for the 1938 season. The team had several excellent players, such as junior Leroy Zimmerman and senior Bill Lewis. In 1935, Bill, known as Bull, became San Jose State's first African-American player. Lewis played fullback as well as linebacker for the Spartans. Bull played four varsity seasons. Bull Lewis was a pioneer in the history of San Jose State football. San Jose State's first All-American, Lloyd Thomas, was also on this talented team. Thomas was chosen as a first-team end for the AP All-America team for the 1938 season. The Spartans' running game was outstanding. The offensive line was devastating. It was led by tackle Jack Sarkisian. The senior was a fierce competitor for the Spartans. As good as the 38 season was, the 39 season was even better. Coach DeGroote and his assistants got help from one of football's legends, Pop Warner. Warner, who had coached Jim Thorpe at the Carlisle Indian School, and also coached Stanford, to an undefeated season and a share of the 1926 national title. Warner had come out of retirement to be a special assistant for the Spartans. And with help from the legendary coach, the Spartans went undefeated for the 1939 season. The team was loaded with talent, including now senior Leroy Zimmerman. Zimmerman was a first-team All-American for the 1939 season. The bruising fullback also played some quarterback and was an outstanding defensive back with 8 interceptions on the season. Sophomore running back Aubrey Minter was an integral part of the team. Another mainstay for the undefeated Spartans was center Bob Bronson. The senior was among the best offensive linemen on the West Coast. He went on to become San Jose State's head coach from 1950 to 1956. In 1952, he influenced one of his reserve ends to go into coaching. Little did the world know that this would change football forever. The player was Bill Walsh, and this young man was to go on to become one of the most revolutionary coaches the game has ever seen. His inventive coaching strategies were very successful, and he was called a genius for winning 4 Super Bowls for the San Francisco 49ers. Walsh was inducted into the NFL Hall of Fame in 1995. Bill Walsh, one of the greatest Spartans of all time. 1995 also marked the 100th year of play for the San Jose State football team. The first game of the year was versus the USC Trojans in Los Angeles. The game was played at the historic LA Coliseum. The Coliseum is one of the state's largest stadiums, holding over 100,000 people. San Jose State's marching band made the trip and made the Spartans proud. USC fan reminded me that I was all alone as a Spartan supporter when I clapped for the SJSU band. The USC marching Trojan band was enormous. I had to ask myself a question when they took the field.
That's the only song I know.
Brought out Traveler, and this horse raced down the entire length of the field without damaging the turf. The famous USC cheerleaders were there for the Trojans, and the San Jose State squad rooted on the Spartans. There was a good crowd there that day. And as the Spartans took the field and the Trojans took the field, it was time for football in California. An interesting fact of the game was walk-on freshman Omar Smith, who in his first collegiate game was assigned to cover All-American Keyshawn Johnson. The team's next road game was a close one, right up the Nimitz to Berkeley, to play the California Golden Bears. The stadium opened in 1926. And held over 75,000 fans in 1995. I was very happy to be in Memorial Stadium. This was the first stadium that I ever visited. I came here as an infant in the 1960s. The stadium is nestled between the beautiful East Bay Hills and the San Francisco Bay. Legendary Tightwad Hill was in use. And the paying customers were ready for a football game between 2 Bay Area schools. I manned the end zone camera for the Spartans, and the video coordinator was the side camera in the press box. The pregame activities at Cal were pretty cool. No horse, but they did have dogs. Cal's drum major led the band to spell out the name of the university. There were Bear cheerleaders on the field and in the stands. And the Spartan cheerleaders were there to root on San Jose State. November 4th, 1995, my father's 62nd birthday, the Spartans went to Jonesboro, Arkansas to play the Arkansas State Indians. Their name changed to the Red Wolves in the 2008 season. My end zone video location was in the stands of Indian Stadium, now known as Centennial Bank Stadium. The game versus the New Mexico State Aggies was played at Aggie Memorial Stadium, a stadium dedicated to the alumni who served in the Korean and Vietnam Wars. The venue opened in 1978 and has the seating capacity of over 30,000 people. After the 1995 football season was over, I videotaped events like volleyball, softball, and women's and men's basketball. When the 1996 football season began, it was back on the road with the Spartans. The Air Force Academy was the first opponent of the season. It was an honor to videotape a game at Falcon Stadium on the campus of the United States Air Force Academy in Colorado Springs, Colorado. Pullman, Washington was the location of the Spartans game versus the Washington State Cougars. Martin Stadium opened in 1972. I was able to watch the band warm up, then go to the press box where Lawrence Fan and Kirk Redfern were waiting for the game to begin. The game versus the Fresno State Bulldogs, we traveled by bus right down Highway 99 to Fresno. It is said that Bulldog Stadium is loudest when games are played against arch-rival San Jose State. I had to climb a ladder to get to my end zone camera location at the top of the scoreboard. Great view of the Bulldog Field, which opened in 1980 and holds 41,000 people. The Spartans played the Colorado State Rams in Fort Collins, Colorado. Kirk made sure that the players loaded on the correct buses to Hughes Stadium. Business manager Al Zitlow was already there waiting for the team. As the players went through pregame activities, I went to the press box for a pregame sandwich. Then I went to my filming location. Another scoreboard. This scoreboard didn't have a ladder on the outside. The ladder was on the inside, amidst huge speakers. There was an electric hoist to bring my equipment up. Once on top of the scoreboard, I had a great view of the stadium that held over 30,000 people in 1996. I had a great time videotaping this football game. During the 1997 football season, I did an internship for the Oakland Raiders. I traveled with the team working with the video department. I operated the on-field video printers. I went to places like Carolina, Tennessee, Kansas City, New York, and of course, the Oakland Coliseum. I met Raider players like Napoleon Kaufman, the head coach, Joe Bugle. In 1998, I became the video coordinator for the Spartans. I hired a competent crew, and we videotaped many hours of San Jose State football practice. Junior Chris Kesteller was the starting quarterback for the 1998 team. He was a very accurate passer, with several good receivers at his disposal. Among them, senior Oliver Newell. Newell could catch the long ball and was an outstanding possession receiver. Junior Dante Scarborough was an explosive player for the Spartans. With outstanding speed, junior college transfer Eric Rule was a threat for the Spartans. The team had two talented sophomore receivers, Sean Green and Joaquin Bailey. Freshman Casey LeBlanc from San Jose was yet another dangerous player in the potent San Jose attack. The tight end was the bruising 260-pound sophomore Sean Brewer. Senior Carlos Meeks was an outstanding halfback for the Spartans. Powerful fullback James Hodgins also played some defense. All-league tackle David Laverne anchored the offensive line, along with fellow seniors center Harry Daniels and tackle Tom James. The defense was led by senior defensive backs Lyle West and Omar Smith, a four-year letterman for the team. Other defensive players included Travis Seaton and James Ditch, Abdul Noah, and linebackers Josh Perry and Ron Jonacuna. Senior David Silverstein handled the kicking duties, and left-footed Tim Morgan, known as Hollywood, was the punter. The most intriguing player in camp was the extremely fast redshirt freshman Deontay Whitaker. A trip to the campus pool was a treat for the team. The players competed in relay races and had a good time. The Simpkins Center, which is located behind Spartan Stadium, was the site of a team barbecue, where head coach Dave Baldwin spoke to the team. Former starting quarterback Carl Dean, who is now an assistant coach, also had something to say to the team. And Simpkins Center was also the site of the end-of-camp celebration. The players did skits that made fun of things that happened during the practices during camp. Roger Ratliff did an imitation of Coach Gaskins, and Coach Throckmorton was mimicked, and even head coach Baldwin was a target. Freshman defensive back Carlos Custis and his teammates sang a song lamenting their long stay at camp. I don't want to be down, living on Saturday. I don't want to be down. senior captain Lyle West had a few words for his teammates.
That's what it's about. What's it doing this year? I can't look forward to September 5th anymore.
Little would anyone know that the player who was most moved by West's speech, Deontay Whitaker, would go on to become one of the greatest players in school history. The team was fired up and ready for the 1998 season to begin. The first opponent of the season was the Stanford Cardinal. Stanford Stadium, which opened in 1921, was the site of my first game as the Spartans' video coordinator. The game started great for the Spartans. Carlos Meeks scored a first quarter touchdown. Dante Scarborough also scored for Coach Barry Sachs was ecstatic after defensive lineman James Ditch's interception. The team played brilliantly to beat Stanford on the road. The Spartan players couldn't contain their joy as they ran to celebrate with the San Jose State fans who came to the game. A great way to start the season for the Spartans. The next road game of the 1998 season was over 2,000 miles away in Charlottesville, Virginia, to play the Virginia Cavaliers. On the day before the game, the buses brought the team to the home of the country's third president, Thomas Jefferson. The visit to Monticello was truly a special occasion. I was photographed with Coach Baldwin at the beginning of the tour. This historic landmark has been beautifully maintained and accurately depicts how the plantation looked when Jefferson lived there. Groundskeepers preserved Jefferson's residence and his garden. A tour that I will never forget. The Cavaliers play at Scott Stadium, which was constructed in 1931 and is the oldest active football stadium in the state of Virginia. The local newspaper gave the news that all 42,000 seats were sold for the game. Football is big in Virginia, and the crowd poured into the stadium. The place filled up pretty quick, with fans on the lawn and in the stands. I went to my sideline video location, and the Virginia video guy surprised me by videotaping me with my own camera. The end zone camera location was good. The Virginia cheerleaders were doing backflips for the Cavaliers. The Star Spangled Banner was performed by a Virginia choir. Asked about the Cavalier mascot.
You guys have a horse?
A horse known as Saber led the Virginia team onto the field. The Spartans took the field, and after the coin toss, it was football time. With a Raiders shirt and Spartan hat, I was ready to videotape the game. The next opponent for the San Jose State Spartans, the University of El Paso Miners. The school was once known as West Texas College, which is near downtown El Paso. The school has a bell hall, and there's a train displayed on campus. The Sun Bowl is an interesting stadium. It was cut into the landscape, and behind the stadium is the Texas Desert. The stadium opened in 1963 and has the seating capacity of 51,000 fans. The Spartans warmed up for the night game played in this legendary stadium. Provo, Utah, home of the BYU Cougars, was the next trip for the San Jose State Spartans. Once again, we arrived a day early, so I was able to tour the city of Provo. It's a nice city, with old buildings and new buildings. I did not have lunch at this restaurant, but I'm sure the food was good. The neighborhoods looked real pleasant, and the October foliage was very scenic. The team was taken to Cougar Stadium, a stadium that is at the elevation of 4,630 feet above sea level. The San Jose State flag looked great with the Colorado Mountains in the background. The players got a chance to stretch their legs by checking out the stands, and were able to contemplate the next day's game. The field was covered for the night, and the game was televised on local television. Behind the stadium is the BYU campus and the Colorado Mountains. The equipment staff made adjustments for the high altitude. The Spartans prepared to play a game that was played on a natural grass playing field. Coaches Carl Dean and Scott Schwartz and myself anticipated a good game at the legendary stadium. The Spartan offense went through plays to prepare for the game. Cougar Stadium is large. It holds over 65,000 people. The end zone camera person had a spot beneath one of the scoreboards. My sideline video location was in the press box again. The stadium began to fill up fast, and many of the fans were there to root on the San Jose State Spartans. Cosmo, the Cougars' mascot, arrived on a scooter. The BYU band was enormous, and they put on quite a show. And the Cougar cheerleaders were quite entertaining. These two cheerleaders cartwheeled the entire length of the field and received a rousing applause from the fans. The end zone video was set and the stadium was packed to the brim. The captains met at midfield and engulfed in smoke, the BYU Cougars took the field. The Spartans played a great game on the road, but they came up just a little short. The game versus the University of Hawaii Rainbows gave me the chance to visit the island paradise for the first time. We stayed at the Hilton Hawaiian Village. There were indoor ponds and special island penguins. The hotel is located on the beach, so the players were able to take a dip in the Pacific Ocean. Some explored the island on foot, others went on rented scooters, Coach Dean rented a Jeep, I rented a mountain bike, and went to the Duke Kahanamoku Beach in Waikiki. Once again, the day before the game, we went to the opponent's stadium to prepare for the game. I found my video location in the press box, and the end zone location was in the stands. Aloha Stadium had an AstroTurf field in 1998. In 2003, it was changed to field turf. Associate Athletic Director Ed Schwartz gave instructions to the Spartans' athletic trainers. Players arrived for team activities. I got my picture taken with the Spartans' radio team, John Schrader, and former NFL football player Bob Lee, as well as defensive end Abdul Noah, who I'd known since he was a freshman. The game versus the Rainbow Warriors was their 1998 homecoming game. Aloha Stadium, which opened in 1975 and holds over 32,000 people, is quite unique. With its pedestrian bridges connecting the sections of the stadium, the crowd was dressed in t-shirts and shorts for this November football game. There were a lot of San Jose State fans who took the trip, and the Spartan band was there to root on the team. Hawaii's band was on hand, as well as the Rainbow Warrior cheerleaders. The color guard presented the colors, and the national anthem was performed by a Hawaiian opera singer. Spartan captains walked out to meet the Rainbow Warrior captains. The Hawaii team entered the field engulfed in smoke, but lost the game to the visiting Spartans. And the San Jose State fans, including Mrs. Simpkins, applauded the team for their victory in Hawaii. This was a big road win for the Spartans. The last game of the 1998 season was much closer, in Fresno, to play the Fresno State Bulldogs. This Fresno game, I have videotaped from the midfield, a great location, and I didn't have to climb a scoreboard. It was a great game. Omar Smith made a punt return for a touchdown.
35-40, he's at the 50, he's going to outrun the punter, 35-30, 20, 10, 5, touchdown, touchdown San Jose State, 6:13 to go on a punt return of 88 yards, how about that?
And senior backup tight end Brandon Knapp caught his first and only touchdown for the Spartans.
Fake the handoff, rolling to his right again. Vi throws, Knapp's got it, touchdown! Brandon Knapp caught it at the 5.
The 1999 offseason camp began with conditioning drills to get the players into shape. Weight training is an important part of camp. The players worked hard at becoming strong and powerful for the upcoming season. Conditioning coaches kept records on players' skills, such as jumping abilities. Chris Casella was now a senior and back as the starting quarterback for the Spartans. His excellent passing abilities made him one of the best quarterbacks in the conference. Head coach Baldwin worked with star running back Deontay Whitaker on avoiding fumbles. Whitaker took heed and always held on to the ball. J.D. Williams and Barry Sachs were two defensive coaches who got into their jobs. The players were trained to swarm the ball. Linebacker Ron John Acuna emceed the end of camp celebration. The evening got started with the Spartans helping out one of their teammates by giving him a free haircut. Oh, he was a little overwhelmed at first. Eventually he relaxed and enjoyed his new look. The players enjoyed dancing and poking fun at their teammates for having short arms or a large nose. They also made fun of their teammates' techniques. And of course, they did imitations of the staff and coaches. Roger Ratliff perfected his imitation of Coach Gaskins. They even joked about two players who were injured in camp. The team had a great time. The 1999 season was at hand and the Spartans were ready for it. San Jose State's first game of the 1999 season was versus LSU in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Because of the kindness of my sister's in-laws, I was able to make it to New Orleans and check out the famous French Quarter. I went to New Orleans landmarks. I even got to see the Mississippi River and the Natchez Steamboat. The game was played at Tiger Stadium. When filled to its capacity of 79,940 people, the stadium ranks as the fifth largest city in the state of Louisiana. The Spartans' defense made big plays in the game, with Abdul Noah pouncing on a fumble that fired up Coach Todd Throckmorton. Junior defensive back Chris Lawson intercepted a tip pass and excited the Spartan sideline. Linebacker Ron John Acuna tipped the ball to himself for another Spartan interception. Deontay Whitaker took a handoff and it was off to the races for the San Jose State Speedster, who scored an 80-yard touchdown run for the Spartans. The powerful sophomore showed the LSU crowd his outstanding skill, rushing for over 170 yards and two touchdowns. In this run, he was able to elude the Tigers' defense and went into the end zone untouched. Quarterback Chris Casella had another solid game for the Spartans, hitting Newell over the middle for a nice gain, and passed to tight end Sean Brewer for another San Jose State touchdown. On September 11, 1999, before the date would go down in infamy, the Spartans played the Colorado Buffaloes. The the University of Colorado has a beautiful campus in Boulder, Colorado. The campus is filled with trees and stately-looking buildings. The Spartans played the Buffaloes at Folsom Field the first year that the stadium was returned to natural grass. More than a mile above sea level, Folsom Field is the third highest stadium in major college football. The mascot for the Buffaloes is Ralphie the Fourth. The Spartans suited up and prepared to play the Colorado Buffaloes in a stadium that sits over a mile in the air. My sideline location was in the press box of this newly renovated stadium. The Spartans' Casey LeBlanc got things started with a run from the 15-yard line into Buffalo territory. Kisteller found Sean Green open for a nice gain. San Jose State's senior quarterback made an outstanding pass to Eric Rule, who ran up the ramp and back down to celebrate with his teammates. Although there were not a lot of defensive highlights in this high-scoring game, the defense was able to stop the Buffaloes on some plays. Travis Seaton made a nice unassisted tackle on a Buffalo ball carrier. A bright spot for the Spartans was the play of quarterback Chris Kisteller. He eluded the Buffalo rush and made several outstanding passes. Making an excellent pass to Steve Pulley for another Spartan score. The explosive Deontay Whitaker had another great game, with a touchdown rushing and another touchdown as a pass receiver. Roger Ratliff made a nice gain for the Spartans and received a pat on the back from a teammate. The Spartans' next road game was another game versus the Stanford Cardinal. I wondered if the Spartans could beat Stanford 2 years in a row. A 15-yard run by San Jose's Patrick Battle was the first touchdown of the game. Darian Morton filled in admirably for an injured Deontay Whitaker by scoring a touchdown for the San Jose State Spartans. Sophomore Casey LeBlanc also scored. The Spartans' defense played great, with stars Abdul Noah and Josh Perry making big plays. San Jose's junior defensive lineman Sam Surratt sacked the Stanford quarterback and received congratulations from his teammates. Spartans defensive lineman James Ditch made an outstanding interception at the line that thwarted another Cardinal score. His teammates were very happy about the play. San Jose's junior linebacker Ron Ockamy scooped up the fumble and ran untouched into the end zone until his teammates mobbed him. All-league kicker Tim Morgan nailed a 44-yard field goal. Steve Pulley had the game of his life with a Spartan record 15 receptions for 255 yards. The junior wide receiver's record-breaking game included two touchdowns that led to another Spartan victory over Stanford. Fort Worth, Texas was the location of San Jose State's next road game to play the TCU Horned Frogs. TCU has a nice campus with yellow buildings and rolling lawns. The Hook'em Horns hand sign has been around since 1955. Once inside Amon G. Carter Stadium, which opened in 1930, the TCU band walked right by me. On my way to the field, I ran into Lynn McClellan from the Spartans business office. I'm not sure what this is, but it made noise and emitted smoke. The Spartans took the field for pregame activities. My video location was high in the press box in a stadium known as Hell's Half Acre. The San Jose State flag flew proudly in the stadium located on the TCU campus near downtown Fort Worth. The two end zone camera operators videotaped the game from a scissor lift on the Walsh Complex. The Horned Frog cheerleaders were very entertaining. And the band's majorette was also very talented. The national anthem was performed by the TCU band.
Interim director of bands at TCU will lead the band in the playing of our national anthem.
The flag bearers for the American flag were much more enthusiastic than the bearers for the Texas flag. And it was football time in the state of Texas between two American universities. San Jose's next road game was also in the state of Texas, this time in Houston, to play the Rice Owls. Rice Stadium is located on the Rice University campus near downtown Houston. The stadium holds over 70,000 fans. The home of the Owls football team since 1950 and hosted the Super Bowl in 1974. My video location was in the press box. The end zone camera was set and ready to go. The Rice band played the national anthem. And once again, it was football time in the state of Texas. The third trip to the state of Texas for the Spartans in the month of October was to El Paso to play the UTEP Miners. I was back in El Paso for another game versus the Miners. I was anxious for the game to get started. The end zone camera was in the stands. The El Paso cheerleading squad was big. They were supportive and performed daring stunts. The Miners band performed the national anthem in the shape of the Star of Texas. UTEP took the field, followed by the Spartans. The San Jose State players were ready to play one of the last games of the 1999 season. Costello rolled out to his left and made a nice pass to tight end Sean Brewer for San Jose State's first score. Return man Joaquin Bailey chose not to fair catch a punt and wove his way through the Miner defenders before his teammates came to escort him into the end zone. Junior defensive lineman Marshall Blunt was not fooled by the El Paso quarterback and wrestled down the Miner for a sack. Sophomore defensive back Carlos Custis blitzed the quarterback and made another sack for the Spartans. San Jose's senior quarterback checked to see if the officials got the call right. He was pleased to see that the call was not offensive holding and it was against the defense. Costello then made a perfect pass to junior wide receiver Joaquin Bailey down to the 2-yard line. It was Deontay Whitaker time, but he was hit at the line of scrimmage, and the sophomore powered his way into the end zone for another Spartan score. Well, there you have it. I had a great time videotaping these Spartan road games. The team played their home games at Spartan Stadium. The stadium opened in 1933 and has the seating capacity of over 31,000 people. The stadium was refurbished in 1998 with a brand new natural field surface installed. And of course, the team played many great games at Spartan Stadium, with the stars shining on their home field. Yes, I videotaped many practices and went to the local stadiums. I was able to travel all over the country to states like Arkansas and Colorado, to the Air Force Academy in Colorado Springs, and to Fort Collins to play Colorado State. Kansas City was among the many places I went during my year with the Raiders. As the Spartans video coordinator, I went to great places like Monticello, Waikiki, and New Orleans. I went to well-known college stadiums like BYU's Cougar Stadium, Colorado's Folsom Field, and TCU's Amon Stadium. I guess always having a video camera nearby is why they call me the video guy.